morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Janice and I very much appreciate the chance to be with you today. As we just recited, there is no tomorrow with respect to listening to the teachings, but at least we have today. We have today. I'm thinking of two words that begin with the letter I, and these words embody the most basic teachings of Buddhism, so we hear them frequently at the temple. Anybody have a guess?
Impermanence.
First word? Impermanence. Thank you. Second word?
Interdependence.
Okay, 100%. The words are an attempt to express the Dharma, which is beyond words. Impermanence and interdependence are pointing us to something inconceivable, something that surrounds us and sustains us, but which we are mostly unaware of. I will illustrate this with a carrot. Nothing more prosaic than that. Most of us rely on carrots for our nutritional needs. This humble root vegetable helps to keep us alive and allows us to hear the teachings of the Buddha. So we should feel gratitude toward it, as expressed by saying, Itadakimasu. How did the carrot end up on our plate, though? Perhaps it came from a grocery store or a restaurant kitchen. The supply chain reached from there back to the field where the carrot grew, involving countless workers like the ones in this photo, people who we will never meet. All of them are helping us to stay alive. Or suppose the carrot came from a backyard garden. Well, in that case, it might seem as though I grew the carrot. There was no supply chain involving other people. It's my carrot. But reflecting more deeply, did I really cause the carrot to grow? Here's something inconceivable is revealed. I refer to the history of life on Earth. Consider how long it took to produce the carrot. It is the result of 2 billion years of natural evolution and 10,000 years of human-aided evolution through farming practices. The carrot had innumerable ancestors reaching back to the remote past. All of these ancestors were necessary for the carrot to be able to grow in the garden and to appear on our plate. The carrot's ancestry is the unseen cause of its growth. Visible efforts by the gardener simply helped the growth along by providing favorable conditions. The inconceivable history of life on Earth is what sustains us, although we have little awareness of it. I would call it a manifestation of the Dharma, the truth of impermanence and interdependence. Today I would like to reflect on the topic of ancestors. Like the carrot, human beings are a product of evolution. Like the carrot, we were produced by countless ancestor species reaching back to the remote past. Today I will mention our human ancestors and our pre-human ancestors. Ultimately, humans and carrots are members of one extended family. As indicated on this chart, we have a common ancestor that lived around 2 billion years ago. A very famous Buddhist monk frequently makes statements such as this: in being human, we are all the same. On that level, none of us are strangers. There are no fundamental differences between any of us. From a Buddhist perspective, it's clear what the Dalai Lama means by this statement. But if one lacks this perspective, the statement appears to be nonsensical. The unawakened mind ignores our fundamental unity and focuses on the differences. It becomes obsessed with features that appear to make our tribe different from other tribes. And so we cause harm to ourselves and to others. Concerning the Dalai Lama's statement, it's likely, I think, that molecular biologists could readily appreciate it, even if they're not Buddhist. These are the people who study the chemical reactions that characterize living things. As far as biochemistry, the biochemistry that occurs within each of us, there is tremendous commonality. The metabolism of every human being is structured in a nearly identical manner, and in this sense, it can truly be said we are all the same. In fact, many of our biochemical pathways are shared not just by humans, but by all species of animals and plants. This biochemical unity should cause us to wonder, how did it come about? Despite the huge difference in body plan and life cycle between, say, a human, a penguin, and a snail, they share the same molecular machinery. At this level, there are not many differences between species. This observation points to a deep truth of nature, a truth that was hidden from human inquiry for a very long time. Humans, penguins, and snails have almost the same molecular machinery because they inherited it from a common ancestor. Just as I and my brothers inherited the trait for blue eyes from our parents, there is a genealogical connection between all living things. The true classification of species is genealogical. It's all about ancestry, the community of descent from extinct predecessors. The evidence is right there in our biochemistry. Let's think first about human ancestors. My wife, Janice, is skilled at genealogical research, that is, finding out about family ties by looking at historical records and by looking at the results of DNA testing. Have any of you done a DNA test for that purpose? A few have. In my case, the results were not too surprising. From this chart, I can infer that my DNA came from people living in Northern Europe perhaps 1,000 years ago, primarily the British Isles and Scandinavia. From historical records, I know that actually half of my ancestors came from England and Ireland, and the rest came to the United States from Germany. And it appears that those German ancestors had a substantial fraction of Scandinavian DNA. Recently, Janice and I were in Minneapolis, and we visited the graves of my great-great-grandparents, who came from Germany to Minnesota in the 1850s. The names on this monument are Christian and Marie Schultz. And together, those two, represent 1/8 of my ancestry. A few years ago, we visited the graves of two other great-great-grandparents who came from Germany to Missouri in the 1840s. Historically, it's unusual for a person of Northern European ancestry to follow the Buddhist path. As you, of course, know, Buddhism has existed in Asia for 2,500 years. Over that time, countless thousands of my ancestors have lived and died, but it's safe to say not a one of them was Buddhist. The conditions for it did not exist. Two things had to happen. First, a few of my ancestors had to come from Germany to the United States, or from Europe in general to the United States. Second, the Dharma had to spread from India. The Dharma had to spread from India through China and Japan, where Shinran received the teaching, and then Shinran's teaching had to be transmitted from Japan to the United States. Without these conditions, I would not have been born into human life, first of all, and I would not have been able to listen to the Buddha Dharma. I am indebted to the great-great-grandparents who came to America, and to the Jodo Shinshu followers who established the BCA, the Buddhist Churches of America. There's a popular TV show called Who Do You Think You Are?, which explores the genealogy of various celebrities. Does anyone ever watch this show? A few people have seen it. The show is interesting, but I will distance myself from the notion that genealogy can answer the question, who are you? The question, who are you, I think, is properly addressed by psychology and religion, not, as I see it, by genealogy, which seeks to answer a different question, namely, who were your ancestors? To think that genealogy answers the question, who are you, suggests a belief in an inherited racial or tribal identity that is not supported by science. It also disagrees with the Buddhist teachings, ancestry, or we might say our past karma, affects our life experiences, but our lives are not completely determined by past karma or ancestry. The choices we make still count for a great deal in understanding who we are. As mentioned, my ancestors lived in Northern Europe around 1,000 years ago. Let's consider the more remote past. Where did our ancestors live 1,000,000 years ago? It appears that they lived throughout Africa and Eurasia. Here I am talking about our pre-human ancestors. Our species, Homo sapiens, did not exist 1,000,000 years ago. We are descended from a line of predecessors that differed from us in terms of anatomy. Figuring out the direct precursor to Homo sapiens is an active area of research in paleontology. Two of our possible precursors from 1,000,000 years ago may have looked like this. In terms of height and weight, they were similar to many of us here, but their skulls were shaped differently. They used tools, they could control fire, and some of them were able to live in cold climates. They shared the earth with several other close evolutionary cousins. That is no longer the case today. There's only one representative of our genus, Homo. Our species arose from this mix of several closely related cousins, and the fossil record shows that anatomically modern people who looked pretty much like us first appeared about 300,000 years ago. They appeared in Africa, and from there, eventually spread across the globe. All of those other close evolutionary cousins eventually became extinct. On a humorous note, some of you might recall this gag from a British TV series. Earthmen are not proud of their ancestors and never invite them round for dinner. Such as this alleged ancestor, but of course, in reality, none of the currently living primates, such as the chimpanzee, is the ancestor of human beings. We and the chimp, however, do have a common ancestor that went extinct around 10,000,000 years ago. Now let's go even farther back in time. Where were our ancestors living 1,000,000,000 years ago?
Underwater.
It's likely that they were living in the ocean, but it's difficult to say much more about them. At that time, animals were in the process of splitting from plants on the evolutionary tree. The life forms were much simpler than the species that we find today, but the biochemistry, the molecular machinery that I mentioned earlier, it was already in place. However, big changes were in store. By 500 million years ago, the oceans were full of complex life forms representing most of the major categories of animals and plants that you are familiar with. One writer on evolution has called the natural arising and perishing of species the greatest show on Earth. For me, the history of life on Earth provides an all-encompassing illustration of impermanence and interdependence. It points us toward the Dharma. Plant and animal species are continually coming into being and dying out in response to causes and conditions in the environment. All of them are descendants of other species that are now extinct. We have countless extinct ancestors who transmitted their DNA to us. And we serve as a temporary container for this genetic information. The DNA of Homo sapiens may, in turn, be transmitted to successor species in the distant future. Given that all life forms are undergoing transformation, there can be no permanent species identities. I think that this recognition is pointing us toward Buddhist awakenings.